It's different now, Mr. Palima. The talks are about to happen post the Jose Maria season era. What are your expectations?
First of all, there is not much, there's no such thing as a post or pre Jose Maria season era. The movement is going on as before. The same principles are being followed, the same aims, the same motivations are there. So we don't see any difference in the handling of the peace negotiations, at least on our part. Mm-hmm. The peace negotiations has gone so many different tortuous developments. Before, it was canceled and abrogated and so on, but there were also progress on several points several times in the course of the peace negotiations. As we know, the current phase of the peace negotiations started in the early 1990s, and since then we have forged some important agreements that is geared towards the resolution of the armed conflict. The parties have, just an example, the parties have signed and approved the comprehensive agreement on respect for human rights and international humanitarian law. This by itself is a very important, a milestone in the peace negotiations. It is the first of four major substantive agendas. And before the peace talks were terminated 6 years ago by then President Rodrigo Duterte, the two parties were in fact well on the way to resolving or agreeing on the second agenda, the comprehensive agreement on social and economic reforms, which is actually the backbone of the whole negotiations, because then by solving the social and economic problems of the nation, then we would be able to change the, eliminate in fact, the root cause of the civil war, and that is unmitigated and really very sad condition of the majority of the Filipino people, poverty and so on.
Yeah. So you were there to oversee the agreements on JASIG and also the Caril, as you mentioned out the. The comprehensive agreement on respect for human rights and humanitarian law. You've been around for quite a while. You can talk to us now, if you can, about the pitfalls that happened throughout these three decades, and how do you avoid it this time around?
Well, if you look at a major pitfall, is the arrest of our political consultants, which are crucial to the negotiations. The few of us in the panel cannot really come forward with the other side, with the other panel, on a significant and viable agreement without the expertise and the assistance of the experts, if you may call, as we call them, on this case, the economy of the country. And without the political consultants, we wouldn't really go forward in any deeper discussions of the social economic reforms. And therefore, we resolved this earlier. We have this JASIG, as you mentioned, the Joint Agreement of the Security and Immunity Guarantees, that is really meant to ensure that the peace negotiations go smoothly without any side fearing for their lives, fearing for their safety. Therefore, we think that the agreement, the JASIC, is a an important, really indispensable part of the process of the peace negotiations. Mm-hmm.
And because there was amnesty granted by the president just a few days back, do you think that this sets the tone?
It helps in the confidence building, as I mentioned earlier, especially if it is really meant to look at the situation of the political prisoners. There are about 800 political prisoners now languishing in jails. Mm. However, you don't really need a formal amnesty in this situation. If you look at the cases of these political prisoners, many of them are jailed on false evidence and trumped up charges. Even if the GRP uses its own laws and its own framework, many of these political prisoners would be released using the already existing legal processes of the other party, the GRP.
We talked about confidence-building measures. We kind of touched on trust a while ago as well. I want to go deeper into that, Mr. Palima. Let's talk about trust and how both sides have been guilty in the past of betraying this trust. Given towards each other. What is the NDFP willing to do to show that you are trustworthy this time around?
Well, what we've been doing all the time is do what we say. And we expect the GRP, the other side, to also do as they say. In other words, trust is not something that you just put on the table and accept. That trust is also deserved. It should be worked on by both sides. And trust is very important. You don't negotiate with a party, or if even personally, don't negotiate personally if you don't have the slightest trust on the other side. So at the bottom, there is trust. So trust, this confidence building measures, as we say, is a not a precondition, but in fact is the meat of what we call trust on both sides. If you don't, the past agreements that we have made, the Hague Declaration, for instance, which is very important as it sets the tone for the framework of the agreements. The JASIC, which is meant to protect the safety of all the participants on both sides. If we have agreed to sign on those agreements before, then you are obliged to respect them.
In other words,
no sign, because you know the parties here are permanent. It's not that we are talking to the administration of President Marcos Jr. Or the administration of President Duterte. We are talking to the government of the Republic of the Philippines, which is an entity that doesn't change.
Yeah,
for as long as something catastrophic happens.
Let me just go back to what you shared with us a while ago, that it was upon the initiative of retired General Bautista that these talks actually began 2 years ago. What was his rationale? What was his reasoning for being the first one to reach out? I mean, it sounds counterintuitive, right? That he would actually, or someone from the military would actually be the one to initiate it, given that it's in their DNA to quell the armed conflict. So what was the reason given then? Why did he have to do it?
Actually, during the course of these 2 years, in close contact with General Bautista, We have not actually talked the personal motivations of things. In fact, we have been associating with each other in the few several times that we had this discreet meetings in the Netherlands. Of course, personal things are not really discussed in them. So we never asked him his motivations. But we indeed asked in very friendly manner what how feasible it is for him to come up with a more formal group in the future, or even if he is even can he do that? Because as we say, he is a retired military officer, and of course that he also of course asked, are you do you have authority to discuss with the prospective panel from the GRP. So all of this are part of the back channel or discrete negotiations.
And here you guys are about to start another round of peace talks under the administration now of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Tell me about your thoughts that this is happening under his watch, considering that his father was even called the greatest recruiter to the movement during his time, because a lot of people then it multiplied, the numbers multiplied because of the way the country is being run then and the various social issues that cropped up then. And now you have this, his son, and this is happening under his son's watch. Your thoughts?
Yes. Well, my own personal thoughts is this. Of course, we said before, we mentioned sometimes in lighter situations that the senior President Marcos has been a big recruiter of the New People's Army. And we even also said the same at the beginning of the term of the present President Marcos Jr. But it's really entirely up to him to follow the same path as his father has taken or not. We do not sometimes say fruits do not fall far from the tree, but we are always open, as we said. If he shows sincerity in talking towards resolving the root causes, the poverty, the social injustice in the nation, then we will be willing to discuss further how this can be done with the cooperation of both parties in many ways. But how this will be done concretely, it will have to depend on the progress of the negotiations. Sometimes you say it's not easy. The social and economic reforms is the bone of the situation in the country. It's the peace talks itself would have to use a lot of time, effort, and sincerity in the solution, in the coming up with the comprehensive agreement on social and economic reforms. We know it's not easy. It will take lots of efforts, time, and most of all, sincerity on both parties to be able to come up with a viable agreement to solve this particular problem.
All right.
The rest of the... Yes, please.
Yeah, I'm sorry, but we run out of time. We're going to have to leave it at that. Eusterio Palima there joining us live from Stockholm, a member of the NDFP negotiating panel. Thank you again for your insights. for taking time out to talk to us. I'm sure we're going to talk in the coming days again as both sides renew the talks for peace. It's been a long, hard process. Hopefully this time around it's as you said, it's never easy, but the hope is that this time around it's going to be different. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.